Chapter 11. A Rapid Diorama. Part 2. Many of the paintings on the walls in the roofless chambers of both cities, or carefully removed to the museum at Naples, are as fresh and plain as if they had been executed yesterday. Here are subjects of still life, as provisions, dead game, bottles, glasses, and the like, familiar classical stories, or mythological fables, always forcibly and plainly told, conceits of cupids, quarreling, sporting, working at trades, theatrical rehearsals, poets reading their productions to their friends, inscriptions chalked upon the walls, political squibs, advertisements, rough drawings by schoolboys, everything to people and restore the ancient cities, in the fancy of their wandering visitor. Furniture, too, you see, of every kind, lamps, tables, couches, vessels for eating, drinking, and cooking, workmen's tools, surgical instruments, tickets for the theatre, pieces of money, personal ornaments, bunches of keys found clenched in the grasp of skeletons, helmets of guards and warriors, little household bells, yet musical with their old domestic tones. The least among these objects lends its aid to swell the interest of Vesuvius, and invest it with a perfect fascination. The looking, from either ruined city, into the neighboring grounds overgrown with beautiful vines and luxuriant trees, and remembering that house upon house, temple on temple, building after building, and street after street, are still lying underneath the roots of all the quiet cultivation, waiting to be turned up to the light of day, is something so wonderful, so full of mystery, so captivating to the imagination, that one would think it would be paramount, and yield to nothing else. To nothing but Vesuvius. But the mountain is the genius of the scene. From every indication of the ruin it has worked, we look, again, with an absorbing interest to where its smoke is rising up into the sky. It is beyond us, as we thread the ruined streets, above us, as we stand upon the ruined walls, we follow it through every vista of broken columns, as we wander through the empty courtyards of the houses, and through the garlandings and interlacings of every wanton vine. Turning away to Bestum yonder, to see the awful structures built, the least aged of them, hundreds of years before the birth of Christ, and standing yet, erect in lonely majesty, upon the wild, malaria-blighted plain, we watch Vesuvius as it disappears from the prospect, and watch for it again, on our return, with the same thrill of interest, as the doom and destiny of all this beautiful country, biding its terrible time. It is very warm in the sun, on this early spring day, when we return from Bestum, but very cold in the shade, insomuch, that although we may lunch, pleasantly, at noon, in the open air, by the gate of Pompeii, the neighboring rivulet supplies thick ice for our wine. But, the sun is shining brightly, there is not a cloud or speck of vapor in the whole blue sky, looking down upon the Bay of Naples, and the moon will be at the full tonight. No matter that the snow and ice lie thick upon the summit of Vesuvius, or that we have been on foot all day at Pompeii, or that croakers maintain that strangers should not be on the mountain by night, in such an unusual season. Let us take advantage of the fine weather, make the best of our way to Resina, the little village at the foot of the mountain, prepare ourselves, as well as we can, on so short a notice, at the guide's house, ascend at once, and have sunset halfway up, moonlight at the top, and midnight to come down in. At 4 o'clock in the afternoon, there is a terrible uproar in the little stable yard of Signor Salvatore, the recognized head guide, with the gold band round his cap, and 30 under guides who are all scuffling and screaming at once, are preparing half a dozen saddled ponies, 3 litters, and some stout staves, for the journey. Every one of the 30 quarrels with the other 29, and frightens the 6 ponies, and as much of the village as can possibly squeeze itself into the little stable yard, participates in the tumult, and gets trodden on by the cattle. After much violent skirmishing, and more noise than would suffice for the storming of Naples, the procession starts. The head guide, who is liberally paid for all the attendance, rides a little in advance of the party, the other 30 guides proceed on foot. 8. Go forward with the letters that are to be used by and by, and the remaining 2 and 20 beg. We ascend, gradually, by stony lanes like rough broad flights of stairs, for some time. At length, we leave these, and the vineyards on either side of them, and emerge upon a bleak bare region where the lava lies confusedly, in enormous rusty masses, as if the earth had been ploughed up by burning thunderbolts. And now, we halt to see the sunset. The change that falls upon the dreary region, and on the whole mountain, as its red light fades, and the night comes on, and the unutterable solemnity and dreariness that reign around, who that has witnessed it, can ever forget. It is dark, when after winding, for some time, over the broken ground, we arrive at the foot of the cone, which is extremely steep, and seems to rise, almost perpendicularly, from the spot where we dismount. The only light is reflected from the snow, deep, hard, and white, with which the cone is covered. It is now intensely cold, and the air is piercing. The 31 have brought no torches, knowing that the moon will rise before we reach the top. 2 of the litters are devoted to the Tilades, the third, to a rather heavy gentleman from Naples, whose hospitality and good nature have attached him to the expedition, and determined him to assist in doing the honors of the mountain. The rather heavy gentleman is carried by 15 men, each of the ladies by half a dozen. We who walk, make the best use of our staves, and so the whole party begin to labor upward over the snow, as if they were toiling to the summit of an antediluvian 12th cake. We are a long time toiling up, and the head guide looks oddly about him when one of the company, not an Italian, though an habitué of the mountain for many years, whom we will call, for our present purpose, Mr. Pickle of Portici, suggests that, as it is freezing hard, and the usual footing of ashes is covered by the snow and ice, it will surely be difficult to descend. But the sight of the litters above, tilting up and down, and jerking from this side to that, as the bearers continually slip and tumble, diverts our attention, more especially as the whole length of the rather heavy gentleman is, at that moment, presented to us alarmingly foreshortened, with his head downwards. The rising of the moon soon afterwards revives the flagging spirits of the bearers, stimulating each other with their usual watchword, courage, friend. It is to eat macaroni. They press on, gallantly, for the summit. From tinging the top of the snow above us, with a band of light, and pouring it in a stream through the valley below, while we have been ascending in the dark, the moon soon lights the whole white mountainside, and the broad sea down below, and tiny Naples in the distance, and every village in the country round. The whole prospect is in this lovely state, when he come upon the platform on the mountain top. The region of fire, an exhausted crater formed of great masses of gigantic cinders, like blocks of stone from some tremendous waterfall, burnt up, from every chink and crevice of which, hot, sulphurous smoke is pouring out, while, from another conical-shaped hill, the present crater, rising abruptly from this platform at the end, great sheets of fire are streaming forth, reddening the night with flame, blackening it with smoke, and spotting it with red-hot stones and cinders, that fly up into the air like feathers, and fall down like lead. What words can paint the gloom and grandeur of this scene? The broken ground, the smoke, the sense of suffocation from the sulphur, the fear of falling down through the crevices in the yawning ground, the stopping, every now and then, for somebody who is missing in the dark, for the dense smoke now obscures the moon, the intolerable noise of the 30, and the hoarse roaring of the mountain, make it a scene of such confusion, at the same time, that we reel again. But, dragging the ladies through it, and across another exhausted crater to the foot of the present volcano, we approach close to it on the windy side, and then sit down among the hot ashes at its foot, and look up in silence, faintly estimating the action that is going on within, from its being full 100 feet higher, at this minute, than it was 6 weeks ago. There is something in the fire and roar, that generates an irresistible desire to get nearer to it. We cannot rest long, without starting off, 2 of us, on our hands and knees, accompanied by the head guide, to climb to the brim of the flaming crater, and try to look in. Meanwhile, the 30 yell, as with one voice, that it is a dangerous proceeding, and call to us to come back, frightening the rest of the party out of their wits. What with their noise, and what with the trembling of the thin crust of ground, that seems about to open underneath our feet and plunge us in the burning gulf below, which is the real danger, if there be any, and what with the flashing of the fire in our faces, and the shower of red-hot ashes that is raining down, and the choking smoke and sulphur, we may well feel giddy and irrational, like drunken men. But, we contrive to climb up to the brim, and look down, for a moment, into the hell of boiling fire below. Then, we all three come rolling down, blackened, and singed, and scorched, and hot, and giddy, and each with his dress alight in half a dozen places. You have read, 1,000 times, that the usual way of descending, is, by sliding down the ashes, which, forming a gradually increasing ledge below the feet, prevent too rapid a descent. But, when we have crossed the 2 exhausted craters on our way back and are come to this precipitous place, there is, as Mr. Pickle has foretold, no vestige of ashes to be seen, the whole being a smooth sheet of ice. In this dilemma, 10 or 12 of the guides cautiously join hands, and make a chain of men, of whom the foremost beat, as well as they can, a rough track with their sticks, down which we prepare to follow. The way being fearfully steep, and none of the party, even of the 30, being able to keep their feet for 6 spaces together, the ladies are taken out of their litters, and placed, each between 2 careful persons, while others of the 30 hold by their skirts, to prevent their falling forward, a necessary precaution, tending to the immediate and hopeless dilapidation of their apparel. The rather heavy gentleman is abjured to leave his litter too, and be escorted in a similar manner, but he resolves to be brought down as he was brought up, on the principle that his 15 bearers are not likely to tumble all at once, and that he is safer so, than trusting to his own legs. In this order, we begin the descent, sometimes on foot, sometimes shuffling on the ice, always proceeding much more quietly and slowly, than on our upward way, and constantly alarmed by the falling among us of somebody from behind, who endangers the footing of the whole party, and clings pertinaciously to anybody's ankles. It is impossible for the litter to be in advance, too, as the track has to be made, and its appearance behind us, overhead, with some one or other of the bearers always down, and the rather heavy gentleman with his legs always in the air, is very threatening and frightful. We have gone on thus, a very little way, painfully and anxiously, but quite merrily, and regarding it as a great success, and have all fallen several times, and have all been stopped, somehow or other, as we were sliding away, when Mr. Pickle of Portici, in the act of remarking on these uncommon circumstances as quite beyond his experience, stumbles, falls, disengages himself, with quick presence of mind, from those about him, plunges away head foremost, and rolls, over and over, down the whole surface of the cone. Sickening as it is to look, and be so powerless to help him, I see him there, in the moonlight. I have had such a dream often, skimming over the white ice, like a cannon ball. Almost at the same moment, there is a cry from behind, and a man who has carried a light basket of spare cloaks on his head, comes rolling past, at the same frightful speed, closely followed by a boy. At this climax of the chapter of accidents, the remaining 28 vociferate to that degree, that a pack of wolves would be music to them. Giddy, and bloody, and a mere bundle of rags, is Pickle of Portici when we reach the place where we dismounted, and where the horses are waiting. But, thank God, sound in limb. And never are we likely to be more glad to see a man alive and on his feet, than to see him now, making light of it too, though sorely bruised and in great pain. The boy is brought into the hermitage on the mountain, while we are at supper, with his head tied up, and the man is heard of all some hours afterwards. He too is bruised and stunned, but has broken no bones, the snow having, fortunately, covered all the larger blocks of rock and stone, and rendered them harmless. After a cheerful meal, and a good rest before a blazing fire, we again take horse, and continue our descent to Salvatore's house, very slowly, by reason of our bruised friend being hardly able to keep the saddle, or endure the pain of motion. Though it is so late at night, or early in the morning, all the people of the village are waiting about the little stable yard when we arrive, and looking up the road by which we are expected. Our appearance is hailed with a great clamour of tongues, and a general sensation for which in our modesty we are somewhat at a loss to account, until, turning into the yard, we find that one of a party of French gentlemen who are on the mountain at the same time is lying on some straw in the stable, with a broken limb, looking like death, and suffering great torture, and that we were confidently supposed to have encountered some worse accident. So well returned, and heaven be praised. As the cheerful Vetterno, who has borne us company all the way from Pisa, says, with all his heart. And away with his ready horses, into sleeping Naples. It wakes again to Polissina and pickpockets, buffoon singers and beggars, rags, puppets, flowers, brightness, dirt, and universal degradation, airing its harlequin suit in the sunshine, next day and every day, singing, starving, dancing, gaming, on the seashore, and leaving all labor to the burning mountain, which is ever at its work. Our English dilettanti would be very pathetic on the subject of the national taste, if they could hear an Italian opera half as badly sung in England as we may hear the Foscari performed, tonight, in the splendid theatre of San Carlo. But, for astonishing truth and spirit in seizing and embodying the real life about it, the shabby little San Carlino theatre, the rickety house one story high, with a staring picture outside, down among the drums and trumpets, and the tumblers, and the lardy conjurer, is without a rival anywhere. There is one extraordinary feature in the real life of Naples, at which we may take a glance before we go. The lotteries. They prevail in most parts of Italy, but are particularly obvious, in their effects and influences, here. They are drawn every Saturday. They bring an immense revenue to the government, and diffuse a taste for gambling among the poorest of the poor, which is very comfortable to the coffers of the state, and very ruinous to themselves. The lowest stake is 1 grain, less than a farthing. 100 numbers, from 1 to 100, inclusive, are put into a box. 5 are drawn. Those are the prizes. I buy 3 numbers. If one of them come up, I win a small prize. If 2, some hundreds of times my stake. If 3, 3,500 times my stake. I stake, or play as they call it, what I can upon my numbers, and by what numbers I please. The amount I play, I pay at the lottery office, where I purchase the ticket, and it is stated on the ticket itself. Every lottery office keeps a printed book, an universal lottery diviner, where every possible accident and circumstance is provided for, and has a number against it. For instance, let us take 2 galleoni, about 7 pence. On our way to the lottery office, we run against a black man. When we get there, we say gravely, "The diviner." It is handed over the counter, as a serious matter of business. We look at black man. Such a number. Give us that. We look at running against a person in the street. Give us that. Apostrophe we look at the name of the street itself. Give us that. Now, we have our 3 numbers. If the roof of the theatre of San Carlo were to fall in, so many people would play upon the numbers attached to such an accident in the diviner, that the government would soon close those numbers, and decline to run the risk of losing any more upon them. This often happens. Not long ago, when there was a fire in the king's palace, there was such a desperate run on fire, and king, and palace, that further stakes on the numbers attached to those words in the golden book were forbidden. Every accident or event, is supposed, by the ignorant populace, to be a revelation to the beholder, or party concerned, in connection with the lottery. Certain people who have a talent for dreaming, fortunately, are much sought after, and there are some priests who are constantly favored with visions of the lucky numbers. I heard of a horse running away with a man, and dashing him down, dead, at the corner of a street. Pursuing the horse with incredible speed, was another man, who ran so fast that he came up immediately after the accident. He threw himself upon his knees beside the unfortunate rider, and clasped his hand with an expression of the wildest grief. "If you have life," he said, "speak one word to me. If you have one gasp of breath left, mention your age for heaven's sake, that I may play that number in the lottery. It is 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and we may go to see our lottery drawn. The ceremony takes place every Saturday, in the tribunal, or court of justice, this singular, earthy-smelling room, or gallery, as moldy as an old cellar, and as damp as a dungeon. At the upper end is a platform, with a large horseshoe table upon it, and a president and council sitting round, all judges of the law. The man on the little stool behind the president is the capo lazarone, a kind of tribune of the people, appointed on their behalf to see that all is fairly conducted, attended by a few personal friends. A ragged, swarthy fellow he is, with long matted hair hanging down all over his face, and covered, from head to foot, with most unquestionably genuine dirt. All the body of the room is filled with the commonest of the Neapolitan people, and between them and the platform, guarding the steps leading to the latter, is a small body of soldiers. There is some delay in the arrival of the necessary number of judges, during which the box, in which the numbers are being placed, is a source of the deepest interest. When the box is full, the boy who is to draw the numbers out of it becomes the prominent feature of the proceedings. He is already dressed for his part, in a tight brown holland coat, with only one, the left, sleeve to it, which leaves his right arm bare to the shoulder, ready for plunging down into the mysterious chest. During the hush and whisper that pervade the room, all eyes are turned on this young minister of fortune. People begin to inquire his age, with a view to the next lottery, and the number of his brothers and sisters, and the age of his father and mother, and whether he has any moles or pimples upon him, and where, and how many, when the arrival of the last judge but one, a little old man, universally dreaded as possessing the evil eye, makes a slight diversion, and would occasion a greater one, but that he is immediately deposed, as a source of interest, by the officiating priest, who advances gravely to his place, followed by a very dirty little boy, carrying his sacred vestments, and a pot of holy water.